Hi everybody, this is Professor Tannenbaum. In today's video, we're going to walk through some of the characteristics that we have to take into account when we evaluate tests and measurements. This can be for any kind of measurement, a personality test, a political survey, a medical test, or your final exam in this course. There are a lot of criteria that are used to evaluate tests, but in this course, we are going to focus on two of them in particular, reliability and validity. The first criterion we need to consider is reliability, which refers to the test's consistency. There are a variety of ways to assess reliability, but one is called test-retest reliability. If a person takes the test more than once, will their scores be fairly consistent? Imagine, for example, that I have a bathroom scale that changes its results by 100 pounds every time I step on and off it. Clearly, this is not a very good scale, and I'm not going to trust it to tell me my weight. Now, imagine that I propose a new measure of intelligence based on hair. Specifically, this test claims that the curlier your hair is, the smarter you are. Would this measurement be reliable? The answer is actually yes, because most likely your hair will be approximately as curly tomorrow as it was today. In other words, this test does meet our standard of reliability, even though it's obviously a horrible way to measure intelligence. That brings us to the second standard we need to evaluate, which is validity. Does the test measure what it says it does? If, for example, someone were to create a new intelligence test, then we would want to make sure it is truly measuring intelligence and not some other type of skill or personality trait. If we are creating a new personality test, then we could assess validity by seeing how well it predicts people's actual behavior. The main thing to keep in mind here is that the same test might be valid for one purpose and invalid for another purpose. If I were to measure a student's cholesterol levels, that would be a completely invalid way to assess how much you've learned in my psychology course, but it might be a perfectly valid way to assess your cardiovascular health. That's clearly a pretty extreme example, but there are plenty of real-life examples out there of tests that aren't entirely valid. For example, if someone has to take an intelligence test in English and it's not their native language, then what you'd actually be measuring is some combination of intelligence and English proficiency. The more difficulty they have with English, the less validly you will be measuring their intelligence. The final point to take away here is that reliability is a necessary but not sufficient condition for validity. In other words, a test can be reliable without being valid, but it can't be valid unless it's reliable as well. If we imagine someone throwing darts at a target, this leaves us with three possible options. Option one, the person's dart throwing is all over the place. It's not reliable, and therefore it can't be valid either. Yeah, they did hit the bullseye that one time, but that was a fluke. Option two, the results are consistent, but not valid. In this case, the person is consistent in their dart throwing, but they're consistently missing the bullseye. This is the equivalent of, say, a clock that's consistently off by 20 minutes. Option three, the assessment is both reliable and valid. In the case of the college, for example, we use assessments for new students to determine which math classes to place you into. A valid assessment would be one that consistently places students in the right class, meaning they're at the right level, not in a class that's too difficult for them to do well in, but not so easy that they're taking a class that they should have placed out. That's it for reliability and validity. Hope you all have a wonderful day today.